A Z score is one of the most useful statistics a sports scientist can use. We are always wanting to know, how does a number compare to a previous set of numbers? That might be comparing an individual athlete's wellness score for today compared to a period of time for themselves previous. It might be comparing an athlete in terms of their physical testing results. Now, sometimes we might use a percentage calculation to flag whether an amount was 10 or 20% higher or lower than normal. But we're often dealing with numbers with different scaling properties. And we're also dealing with athletes who, some athletes might score or report a real varied range of numbers. And other types of tests or athletes might be a lot more narrow. So we want to somehow take into account the norms for their data. And the Z score, the Z score in American, or a standardized score, as it's also known, allows us to do that. The number it gives us is actually the number of standard deviations away from the mean. So here we have a standard normal distribution curve, also known as a bell curve, which tells us that more trials and results occur around the mean and less of those results occur at the outer edges, the tails of that data. And this is what a Z-score is based upon, because plus one to minus one of a Z-score, the plus showing that the score that we're comparing is higher than the average, and negative is reverse. So that means it's lower. That plus one to minus one Z-scores will represent about 68% of the values in your data. Plus two to minus two will represent about 95%. And this is linked to that key number, 0.5 for statistical. And technically 99.7% of the values are expected to be within this plus three to minus three Z-score range for a normally distributed data set. Now, if this formula looks scary, don't worry, it really isn't. And you'll be able, in a few moments after watching this video, you'll know this formula inside out. So this is what all those fancy symbols represent. We take the score that we want to calculate the Z-score for, that's our X, and we take away the mean of our comparison group, and then we divide it by our standard deviation of our comparison group. And that then gives us our Z score. So let's start with a very simple example. Let's say that we have a score for an athlete today of 9.4. Whatever that might be, it might be a test, a speed, a wellness score, but today is 9.4. Their average is 8.1. And their standard deviation for that range that we're comparing it to is 1.2. So to calculate our Z score, we want to do today for the individual subject, subtracted by their average, and then divide that by the standard deviation. And that gives us a Z score of 1.1. So we know that 9.4 is higher than their average of 8.1. And it's 1.1 standard deviations for their data set away from their average. So remember, the plus one to minus one is about 68% of the values. So this is higher than average, but we wouldn't say this is statistically higher than average. Often people have their flags set plus or minus 1.5 or plus or minus two. Perhaps you might have some sort of amber flag that is set at plus or minus one Z score, and in which case this example would flag. Now, I'll be honest, Excel actually has a standardized function specifically for Z scores, and we can see that that formula is equals standardized X, mean, and standard deviation, the three components that we would expect. But for the sake of this video and keeping reinforcing that calculation, I'm going to not use the standardized formula and keep almost calculating it manually so we can keep reinforcing that. Now we'll move on to looking at how does one athlete compare to a group. So here I have a number of different test results for 10 different athletes. First thing I'm going to do is just calculate the average and standard deviations using the Excel functions for each metric. So we have those to refer to. Now I'm going to mirror this table here and create a replica, but this time using the Z scores for each corresponding result. So we'll start with mass of athlete A. And if you remember, our formula is their score, take away the group average, divide it by the standard deviation. So we see a result, a Z score of 1.37. Their mass is 130 compared to the group average of 103.5. So they are 1.37 Z scores higher than the group. And if you remember from the bell curve distribution, plus one to minus one is about 68% within a normally distributed data set. So this is above average. It wouldn't be statistically significant. Now, if I was going to drag this down, all the cells in the formula are going to shift with it. So we're going to get an error because now it's not looking in the right place for the average and standard deviation. So a fantastic little trick in Excel is to use the dollar sign within a formula to anchor the cells. So if we wanted to anchor a column, we would put a dollar sign before the letter, the column. If we want to anchor a row, we put a dollar sign before the number. In this case, we do want to anchor the rows. We want it to always be looking at rows 13 and 14 for the average and the standard deviation, respectively. So in our top formula here, I'm going to leave B2 alone because we want that to shift as we move this formula and copy and paste it. But before the 13, I'm going to put a dollar sign. And before the 14, I'm going to put a dollar sign. And now when we drag our formula down, or copy and paste it, however you wish to do it, we see the error's gone. If I select this one, we are now getting athlete F's score compared to the average and standard deviation every time in every row. So I can also now drag this across and we see we get the Z score for every metric that we've got here in the table. For instance, here we've got for athlete A, their strength in column H being compared to the group average and standard deviation. Now, perhaps what I want to do is add some conditional formatting to this table so that my flags are automatically highlighted. So I'll highlight this array and I'll go into conditional formatting, a new rule. Lots of different ways that we can format based on different types of conditions. In this case, I'm going to do only format cells with a cell value greater than or equal to 1.5. So if someone's test score is 1.5 Z score, then I want that highlighted. And I'm just going to pick for now orange. And we can see that our peak power for athlete B is higher than 1.5 Z scores. And also a number of our results for athlete F are also highlighted. Thank you to Action Apps for sponsoring this video. Action Apps have revolutionized athlete management systems with their unparalleled flexibility and superior technology, trusted by top sports organizations worldwide. Their cutting-edge data visualization and analytics reports, along with customized apps, empowers you to make better, more informed decisions. Check out actionapps.co.uk for more information. Now, I want to show a second way that we can calculate it. So I'm just going to hide this for a moment, and we're going to do the same thing. Imagine we don't have our average and standard deviation on the spreadsheet. What we can do is we can nest that calculation within the formula itself. So we start with the score in question. We want to take it away, remember, from the group average. And in this case, I'm going to nest that average calculation within this formula, and then we're going to divide it. Same thing, including the standard deviation in the formula. And we can see that we get our 1.37 Z score for athlete A's mass again. But if I now copy and paste this formula, drag it down, although we're getting numbers, these technically are incorrect because the average and standard deviation group is moving down every time we copy again. So we want to use our dollar sign trick again to anchor the hormone. So we want it to be B2 to B11 in relation to our average and standard deviation calculation. We want to anchor the row, not the column. So we're putting it before the number. In this case, now when we drag it down, okay, we can see that we've got the Z score. And again, our conditional formatting is showing up and looks very similar. If I unhide our first group and we can directly compare that, as we should have, we've got the exact same Z scores being calculated and the same ones being flagged. So it just depends on the structure of your spreadsheet. Something that I like to do personally, rather than have our average and our standard deviation below, you can put it above almost as a column header, particularly if you know you're going to keep adding to the data set below. But one example where that might not be relevant, here we're going to look at one athlete over time. Now, this could be an RPE score, it could be a wellness score. I want to compare today to a set period of time previously. So in this instance, I don't want to know today compared to the entire season. I want to have more of a rolling average. So maybe I want to compare to today to the last 2 weeks, so the last 14 days. I actually want to compare today here to the average of the previous 14 days and divide that by the standard deviation of that same time frame. And we can see now we get our Z score. 3 is 0.7 standard deviations lower because it's negative. And now when I drag this down, you can see that our point of comparison also moves with it in a way that is correct, unlike that previous example we were looking at. And again, if I add some conditional formatting here, greater than 1.5, we can see a number of flags here where that athlete now is logging 4 or 5, whereas before, again, I could put the conditional formatting for minus, and we could see here in this time frame that for them, compared to themselves over a select period of time, they did go through a period of time where they were reporting a lower number and now reporting generally much higher number. But Z scores are way more valuable than just the score and some conditional formatting. They also can help us with some of our visualization and give us some really meaningful charts without people and the reader having to understand the underlying statistic. Let's take a look at a couple of examples of data visualizations from today's sponsor, Action Apps. So here we just have some demo data in a demonstration account with Action Apps. And if we think back to the testing data we were looking at ourselves earlier, this really does suit visualization in a radar plot, whereby we can compare an individual athlete's results across a number of different tests, either to the whole squad, we can compare them to a position average, or we can plot them against another athlete, as shown here, for example. We might want to plot our Z scores over time, particularly those that we are collecting on a regular basis, such as with our subjective data like RP or wellness. So we can see here a trend over a period of time, but we could also, in this instance, click in and explore the individual Z score trends for different athletes over the time frame, in this case here to their own data set.